Time to announce that this Wednesday lecture in English will become from now on every Monday. Okay, I want the people on the video also to see. Every Monday here, this is my second lecture for the night. 10:15, okay? 10:15, try to be here. And that's where we start. Okay, now. Please put all your phones on vibration or shut it, whatever. Okay. You know, very strange things happening in the last 2 weeks in the world. A few million birds are falling burned from heaven. Not really burned, they dying. In the beginning, it was only in one place, so you thought maybe it's a poisoning, some kind of poisoning. But then you hear it's in Australia and in another country, in Europe, here, there, in America, in different states. Very interesting. And all the birds that are dead are all black. All black birds. Completely black. Not one dot. Black, yeah, black crows and other birds, but all black. If you think that's all, then millions of fish also were found dead in different places.
Why?
Usually, when Hashem brings some kind of a problem to the world, if you want to see hint about it, you go and check in Parashat HaShavua or the Haftarah of that week. Usually it's related, it's connected, usually. Not always, but the things that are happening in the world, you always have some kind of hint inside the Parashat HaShavua. It's very interesting. The Parashot of the 10 plagues, Aseret HaMakot, that Hashem hit Egypt, the animals, the fish, the Nile, the water. These 2 weeks, this is what happened. The birds and the fish, and who knows what's next. Who knows what's next. I started to say in my last lecture something very sad. Not only that fish are dying and birds are dying, people are dying. Many, many people are dying from this horrible cancer disease that is growing weekly. Every week, if you check the statistic, I promise you, it will be worse than the previous week. Nobody understands what's going on here. It became, of course, two and a half years ago, it became the number one cause of death in the world. It used to be heart attack. Now cancer is by far, and it's growing. Just yesterday I found out another guy in his 40s, a head of a family with children, young person, found out that he has it. Wow. Every 10-15 minutes the phone gets another message, please read Tehillim for this one, for this baby, for that family, for this accident, for that cancer, for this horrible, for this heart attack, for coma. It used to be that I used to hand my wife names of how many people call me every week to read Tehillim for her. She reads Tehillim every day, so I give her a list. Read for here, for this, for that, for Zivug, for that. You know, it used to be normal list, one page. Now you need a book. Soon it's going to be thicker than the Tanakh, unfortunately. And almost 90% of them is cancer. Almost 90%. To read Tehillim takes half an hour for these people. An hour, whatever, depend on a woman. Some have more time, some less. Not easy when you have 7 kids, but to read the list takes longer than to read the Tehillim. And that's explained the situation that the Jewish nation is in right now. To read the list, if you have to go name by name, Ploni but Ben Ploni, Ploni but Ploni, Ploni, blah, 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 blah. To read the list is longer than to read the Tehillim. Scary, scary, mama scary. No, very, very scary. Ay, 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 ay. That's not what I wanted to talk about. Then we're going to speak about different kinds of things. But the Torah says, Arur makle avi ve'imo. A person who embarrassed his father and his mother, he received the worst curse in the Torah. In the whole Torah, there's one word that, believe me, not one normal person wants to be belong in the same category. There is a good category that's called Baruch, blessed, and there is Arur, which is cursed. If you take every normal person, a Jew, non-Jew, you ask him, what do you want to be? Cursed or blessed by God? Do you know one person in the world that will say, I want to be cursed? You find one person that want to be cursed by God? Nobody. One time, I almost found one, but I know he's lying, and in the end, I'll tell you what happened. One time, I was sitting in yeshiva, and one guy comes to me and says, Rabbi, there's somebody outside. I want you to sit with him and prove to him that the Torah is divine. I said to him, you know, in yeshiva, there's a lot of noise. It's not an atmosphere for a long argument now, the noise of all the learning. He told me, no, he doesn't even have a kippah. He doesn't want to put a kippah. I cannot let him in the yeshiva. You have to go and speak to him outside, on the street. Say like this, in the street. So you know what, I have an idea. We sit in a car. The car is parking on the street. Let's talk to him, see who he is. I'm sitting with him for more than 2 hours. I give him a personal seminar. And I see that everything I say, he continue with this thing. In the end, I realized, let's not waste the whole day with this guy. So I told him, okay, I have to go now. So I want to just ask you one final question I ask him. So everything I proved to you now, the Torah is divine or no? He said, you didn't prove to me anything. And I gave him the best proofs that convinced everybody. For 15 years, everyone was convinced. Torah and science, you saw the video. You watch it, that's it. You don't have any more doubts. I give him all the thing. Now, he didn't know that I learned a body language. Very good, I learned it. Why I need to learn it? Because it's very important for a speaker that comes to argue with people. A speaker that speaks about Parashat HaShavua, it's a little bit important. You can learn if the audience are interested in your lecture or not. That's it. It's not the end of the world. Wars come to us, they're not so interested. One time they are, one time they're not. No, nobody dies from it. But when you argue with a person, it's a matter of life and death. It's like a doctor that has an opportunity to save someone's life, or he makes a mistake and he dies. The patient dies. If the patient dies, he was 40, so he lost 30 years of his life. So the doctor can sit and eat his heart. Oh, if I would be a little bit better, I would save his life. But it's only 30 years, 40 years, 50 years, 70 years the most. Here, it's a matter of life and death for eternity. You either save his soul forever, and he goes to life of eternity, or he goes to life of eternity in the worst place you can think of. So it's a critical moment. It's not a joke. You need to know. You have to do it the best way possible. So why it's important to know their body language? Because you want to know who to waste energy and who not to waste energy on. The word waste is not a good word. To spend energy. That's the right word. Because it's never a waste. Why? If you have 100 people sitting in the audience and one guy argue with you, if you know body language, it takes less than a minute to know if this person is convinced already or not. If you don't know, you may believe him. You're going to spend 2 hours with him, and in the end he was all convinced. It's just a matter of ego. He doesn't want to lose the argument, so he continues until tomorrow. He'll never admit. You don't want to waste time on a guy like this. He ruins the entire lecture because other people that are really not convinced yet, you have to put your energy in them, not in him. He's already in. He will never admit. That's the good thing about CDs, that most people have high ego. To argue with them in front of a people, they'll never admit. When you give them the CD, they sit home alone with their television, they begin to cry. Why? Nobody is watching. So now there's not another matter of, I have to resist. I have to. If not, all my friends going to say, the rabbi made you like this. It's all about ego. That's the advantage about giving a person a DVD. But, so I'm sitting with this guy, and I see that he's very nervous from what I show him. Because he begins to realize that all his life was one big mistake. So in the end I told him, so I did not convince you? He said, nothing. Now I'm even more convinced that it's nonsense. So I said, so the Torah is nothing. He said, nothing, that's it. So I said, okay, so I want to ask you one little thing and then we go. He said, okay. I said, here, say in the name of the Torah, in the name of the writer of the Torah is full of curses. May all the curses that the writer wrote in his book will come on you and your family. Say amen. He looked at me. He said, what? Did you just curse me? I said, I'm not cursing you. I'm saying, in the name of the writer of the Torah, all the curses in this book, you say it's nothing, no? Say it's nonsense, nothing. Make it will come on you. Just say amen. What do you care? No, I won't say amen. What is this? He looks at the guy. Now, in the meantime, we have an audience. If you know Monsi, you sit with the guy without the yarmulke and argue. You have 50 people around the car already. All the Hasidim, they all are curious to see. So I say, say amen. No, yes, no. I'm not saying amen. I say, why? If a Muslim guy come and say in the name of Muhammad and his Quran, the curses in the Quran will come on you, I'll say a million times amen. Who is he? What do I care? He has the power, Bichlal? He was a real prophet? No. What do I have to lose? Say amen. Fine. No, no. I won't. No. All of a sudden, they really got me by a surprise. He started to cry. Mamash like a baby. You saw a baby that you take away his candy, how he scream? He's crying like this. I got nervous. I didn't know what's going on. He said, you got me, you got me. I say, so why are you wasting my time? From the first 5 minutes, I knew you convinced already. Well, you knew that if you say, yeah, you prove to me the Torah is divine, what's going to be my next step? I'm going to tell you, so how can you live in a lie? Come and change. Don't want to change. So you find all kinds of tricks. But if you will be clever, you would know you're not lying to me, you're lying to yourself. What's the point? But when a person admits, he begins to suffer. Remember this. When a person admits, it came out of his word, out of his mouth one time. Yes, the Torah is real. From that moment on, he doesn't enjoy sins anymore. He begins to suffer. Why? Every time he makes a sin, his conscience begins to work. Look what you just did. Hashem is watching you. Don't you remember a week ago you argued with the rabbi for an hour, now you come and do the same thing? He begins to suffer. He listened to a CD about Shabbat. How this guy was here on Wednesday, remember him? He's not here today. The guy that was sitting here in a third chair. What did he tell me? I said, are you going to dare to be Mechalel Shabbat one more time? Yeah. Say, you're crazy? After what I just heard? You left me no choice. With the cigarettes. You were here on Monday. It was Monday. I explained to him how every time he touched the cigarette, it's not one cigarette, it's every time. It's a separate Chilul Shabbat. So after that, I'm going to dare to be Mechalel Shabbat. Now, it's very possible that he kept his word. It's also very possible that after a few days he began to forget. But believe me, every time he's going to light a cigarette, these words are going to come to his head. That's called conscious. Conscious is a wake-up for Hashem to wake up the people. So, so the Torah says like this, Arur makle avi ve'imo. If you hit your father or your mother, what punishment the Torah says? What punishment? If blood came out, or they got black and blue, which also consider like blood came out, it's death punishment by the Jewish court. A person who hit his parents. I'm not talking if he pushed them, or even gave them a smack, which is also a very big sin. But the Torah meant chovel, chovel, which means one blood came out, a drop of blood, or blood came out, but the skin is holding the blood in. That's called already an execution. That's it. No return from that. Ay, forgive me, Abba, I'm so sorry, I'm such a fool, it's too late. Two witnesses saw it, execution, end of story. Now, why do I tell you this? I'm sure none of you hit your father, no, or your mother. Well, today cannot be so sure anymore, but why do I tell you this? Why? Why? You know why? Because we have a very important learning in the Torah. It's called Kal Vachomer. What does it mean, Kal Vachomer? In English, it means needless to say. It's needless to say. What does it mean, it's needless to say? If I tell you, a person who stole $10,000 from a bank got 10 years in prison. Then I tell you another story. Another person who stole $10 million from the bank, it's needless to say that he got at least 10 years, no? If a person that stole 10,000 got 10 years, someone who stole 10 million, it's 10 and up. Can be 15, can be 20, can be 50 years, who knows? Depend. Everybody understand, if you go to court and they caught you stealing $100, if you stole $1 million, the judge doesn't give you the same punishment. It's interesting because in Judaism, besides the theft, you have to pay double than what you stole. You stole 100, you have to pay 200. You stole 100 million, you have to pay 200 million. That's the law. But in Judaism, the laws, the court, doesn't go by the amount of the money. Because din pruta ke din me'ah. Din pruta ke din me'ah. So, for instance, if you want to give a status of a thief to a person, it doesn't really matter if he stole $5 or $5 million. To make him a title of a thief, if he was convicted already 3 times, that's a chazakah of a ganav, even though he only steal $5-$10 each time. That's a ganav. Cannot rely on this person. You don't have to give him a job, you cannot leave him in your store, you have to watch him. If somebody stole from this room something, he's the one. The police come, 3 times this week, $10 disappeared from this apartment. Here is the guy. Why? He was already convicted 3 times by the Beit Din. He's the thief. Even if he wasn't the thief. Why? We don't have to give him a benefit of the doubt. We don't have to give him a benefit of the doubt. Why? Because it's already chazakah of a ganav. Which means a person that stole 1 time a big amount, and a person who stole 3 different small amounts, the person who stole 3 times is worse than the one who stole a big amount. Why? He already has a chazakah, certainty, that he's a ganav, you cannot rely on him. Person stole once, maybe it's a one-time mistake, and then right away he made tshuva and he will never do it again. Same thing with axe. If you have an axe, your axe, he can eat a cow and kill it. First time, you pay only half a penalty. Half. The cow worth $2,000, you pay $1,000. Second time, same thing. Third time, my friend, it's a certainty. You gotta pay full amount, you don't have any more discounts. Why? 3 times, it's a certainty. You had to watch your ox, because it's already a guarantee that it's going to happen. So why am I telling you this needless to say law? Because the Torah says like this. This is where Chazal come and teach us a very important thing. They say like this. If a person that disrespected his parents in public, it's called makle, make them look cheap. My father is a bum. My father is a pig. He eats like a pig. Oh, my father, don't believe what he say. Oh, my father is sick, you know, he needs attention. All kinds of things that I hear from people, sometimes my ear falls off, right? If a person does this, the Torah called him Arur. Who was cursed in the Torah to be called Arur? The snake. Not a lot of places to sit. No, make them maybe room. No.
In 2 chairs, you can take this.
We have more chairs inside or no?
You take these two.
Here, there's 2 chairs there. Yeah. No, it's okay. They're gonna have 2 people over there. Okay, So, who was the first one in history that Hashem called him Arur? The Nachash, the snake, the symbol of the Yetzer Hara, of the evil inclination. Where else we find the word Arur in the Torah? When the Ar Eval and Ar Grizim, they took the tribe and divided them to 2 halves. Some of them stand towards Ar Eval, some towards Ar Grizim. All the mitzvot of the Torah, they said, Baruch, someone who does it is blessed. Someone who doesn't do it, or someone who makes a sin, is cursed. Arur. What's the last thing on that list? Who remember? What's the last thing of the Arur list? There's at least, I believe, about 10 different curses. Arur, 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 arur. The last one is mamas shocking. Shocking, mamas shocking. What is it? Arur, asher lo yakim et divrei ha-Torah hazot ve'amar kol ha'am amen. Ma ze lo yakim? What does it mean, lo yakim? If he wanted to say, someone who doesn't keep my whole Torah is cursed, then he would have to use the word yekayem, or ishmor, not yakim. Yakim means bring up back on your feet. Someone collapsed, your donkey collapsed, too much weight on his back, your friend's donkey, you help him to bring him up on his leg. You take a bag of flour off, you make the donkey stand, and then it's called yakim. Yakim means you don't have a synagogue, you make a synagogue. It got up, it raised. Everything that was down and now it's up, it's called yakim. What does it mean, arur asher lo yakim et divrei ha-Torah hazot? Someone who would not support and be a foundation to the Torah, someone who will support, someone who will not support the Torah is cursed. Not someone who doesn't keep the Torah. They already gave you a list of someone who doesn't keep the Torah. This one cares. This one cares. All of a sudden, the last one, from this, I want to tell you something that you maybe never thought about it before. Is it possible that we have a situation that we go to collect tzedakah from people, and there are certain people that we're not allowed to ask for tzedakah from them? What do you think?
Not really.
The truth is, when you come to a person to ask him for tzedakah, if he gives you, you made him a very big favor. We know that already. You gave him a favor to invest in something holy. Otherwise, what would he do with his money? Probably sins or nothing. Now you took away money from him, you made mitzvah with that, you support the yeshiva, you do something good, synagogue, this, food for the poor, you help a poor family. You did something good with that. Something good came out of his money. You open him a merit, a schut, to do more mitzvot. This is what David HaMelech says in Tehilim. I'm sure we said it 1,000 times, and we don't pay attention to what we say. What's the most popular mizmor in Tehilim? From 150 different chapters, which chapter is the one that was read more than anyone in history? Shir Lamalot, right? Shir Lamalot. Every time of problem, Shir Lamalot, Esayinai Learim. So this is the one that was said the most in history, probably by far. There are other ones, Ashresh Vebetecha, Shir Lamalot, Mimamakim Kraticha Hashem. There are a lot of famous ones, but this one by far is the most frequent one. The question that I have, by the way, even the Spanish people read it in their churches, in South America, in Honduras, Chile, Argentina. They say it in Spanish. So the question is, why David HaMelech say, Ezri me'im Hashem? My help will come from Hashem, but he doesn't say it in a proper way. Ezri should be me'et Hashem, or me'Hashem. That's the proper Hebrew. Ezri, my salvation, will come from Hashem. This is what it says. My salvation will come with Hashem. With Hashem? What's the call? It's not the proper talking. Ezri me'im Hashem. What's the hint here? Where my salvation will come from? Not that Hashem will send a hand from heaven and will bring me up, or will give me a candy, or will give me $1,000,000. It usually doesn't happen that a hand comes from heaven and put it in your hand, or that Hashem comes to you as he spoke to Moshe or to Avraham Avinu. It doesn't happen. It happens once in a blue moon to one unique individual that is an extreme big tzaddik. But for most people, righteous people, it doesn't happen. Where Hashem helps these followers, how does he do it? Through other followers of his. This is called killing two birds with one stone. But here to the positive side. Killing, it's negative. Reviving two stone with one medicine. How can you do it? Two birds. Two birds with one medicine. How? You're thinking Reuven that is a righteous person and he needs help. And he's sending him Shimon, that is another righteous person, to be the one who has the merit to save Reuven. So you got Reuven what you wanted to give him, and you gave a bonus to Shimon by choosing him to have the zchut, the merit, to be the one who saved Reuven. Why? Because like this, not only you help one son of yours, you help your other son with one transaction. Which means, David HaMelech say, I know the rule, Hashem. If my salvation will come, it will come only from one of your followers. Ezri me'im Hashem, those who with you, im, it's together. Those who are together with you will help me. Those who are your aiders, not only they won't help me, I'm not even expecting any help from them. Even if they offer, I'm not interested. The entire Tehillim is, Mesanecha Hashem Esna. Those who hate you, Hashem, I hate them. If they hate you, right away they become my enemies. Now, don't get the wrong impression here. I'm not telling you that you have to go and kill them or do something to them. That's a different story here now. What is it like? One person comes to you and says, you know, Yosef, I hate your father very much. Now, you know your father is not a perfect person. You know. Sometimes he does good things, like most people today. They do good and bad mixed. But somebody comes and says to you, I hate your father so much. He begins to talk against your father. And you go like this. Oh, really? I understand you. Yeah, I'm sorry. You know, I wish my father wouldn't be like this. This is a very big sin. You have no permission to make even a hint to talk against your father. Even to turn your father to the police, you don't have permission unless if he's risking other people's life. He drives under alcohol or drugs, and you warn him many times, and then you know it's just a matter of time until he kills a Jew. That's a different story, because you're not really doing something against him, you're doing something for him. Maybe that's the only way he will understand not to drive with drugs or alcohol or anything like this. Or other situation, but just to come and to be a witness against him, or to testify against your father that they have to execute him, they don't even accept your testimony. Lo yumtu avot al banim, lo yumtu. It cannot be a part of the Torah. Hashem is not interested that a son will turn against his father, like Avshalom did against David HaMelech. It's a very big thing. So what's going on here? If a person come and speak to you anything against your father, right? Something like this, right away he becomes your enemy. Why? How can you love someone who just speaks and wants to damage your father? He wants to damage your father. Now remember, respecting your father and mother, even when they're not the nicest parents in the world. Nowhere in the Torah it says you have to respect your father only if he gives you 10 kisses a day and $1,000 a day to spend. You have to respect your father whether you hardly see him because he's at work all day, whether he was very stingy with you, whether he wasn't the greatest father, he didn't teach you enough Torah, he didn't put you in the best school in the world. You still have obligations to him. And you don't have to respect your father because he brought you to the world. If Hashem wanted, he would bring you to the world from a tree. You would go inside an orange, an orange will fall on the floor, break to two, a little midget comes out, and that's it. He doesn't need your father and mother to bring you to the world. Why do you have a father and mother? Because Hashem wanted you to, when the Torah was written, it was before the world was created. It was given to us inside our life here, 3,300 years ago. But the Torah was really here before. The Torah was here before. After reviewing the Torah, Hashem created the world based on His Torah, not the Torah based on the world. Remember, what comes first? When a company makes a car, what do they have first? First they have the car and then they sit and write a manual? Or first they have all the system already in a computer and the manual is printed and then they make the car? Most people think first they make the car and now when they have the car they know what to write. You want to blink? Do this. You want to change oil? Do this. No, my friend. When they designed the car, before there was any car, first they had the manual and the blueprint of the car. Everything goes here, there. They know all the size, the engines, the wires, everything. After that, they made the car. You have parents because in the Torah of Hashem it says, Kabed et avicha ve et imecha. It's one of the 613 laws. You don't have to respect them because you have parents. You have parents because you have to respect them. The other way around. Reverse. You understand? If you're not interested, you don't have to be here. You can go. It's no problem. Yeah.
What if your father, for example, is a goy, and you haven't seen him for 20 years?
Even a goy father, you have to respect him. To respect him. Even when he died, you're allowed to say Kaddish on him.
Yeah.
Yes. Rav Ovadia Posek, in a shoot.
A goy?
Yeah, on a goy. We're not talking a goy that hates Jews. If your father is an anti-Semite, goy is a different story. I didn't say that you have to live by him and feed him and support him. No. But you're not allowed to disrespect him. You're not allowed to speak bad about him, even if he's a goy. You owe him a decent respect, like you have to give respect to every person that Hashem created. The Torah said that when the enemies of God are drowning, they were about to kill us. The Egyptians came to kill us. We're crossing here. It's this parasha, this Shabbat. Vayi b'shalach. Right? This is the parasha of Yetziat Mitzrayim. The Jews went in, 600 carriages of Paro are following the Jews, what? To give them a kiss? For what? To return them back to slavery or to kill them, one of the two, depending if they fight or not. And Hashem drowned them, and the Jews wanted to sing, to praise Hashem, the angels, I should say, the angels, and Hashem told the angels, Ma'asei adai tovim bayam v'atem omrim shira. My creation is drowning and you want to sing? What, are you happy? What do we have in halacha? Binfol oivecha al tismach. When your enemy is collapsing, don't be too happy. A person that his friend got punished because of him cannot be together with Hashem in Olam Abad. Did you know it? You have a stain. I repeat it again. Let's say your friend did something bad to you and you refuse to forgive him. You're stubborn, you don't want to refuse, you don't want to forgive him. And then he died. He had an accident and he died because of what he did to you. Now, one day you die also. You come to heaven and Hashem says, you see what this guy did to you? Remember? That's why he died, for what he did to you. And you say, wow, I'm an important person. Because of me, look, Hashem, whoever messed with me, I have a special protector. Only a fool will be happy. When you see what happened to a person, even though he was guilty, don't get me wrong, we're not talking about an innocent person here. He's a guilty person. But because he got punished because of you, your file cannot be clean anymore. Why? A Jew got punished because of you. I'll give you an example of what it means. Three people are punished when the Lashon Hara is taking place. The one who speaks, that's obvious. The one who enjoy hearing it, that's obvious. And the one who they are talking about. The one who speaks is the worst. The one who listens is second worst. Because if you would tell him, I'm not interested, don't talk Lashon Hara with me about anyone, then not only you wouldn't make a scene, you would save yourself from making a scene, right? The third one, this is the one who they are talking about. Right? So the question is, we need more chairs here, Dina. What's going to be, Dina? May we break the wall? All right. No, here. Okay, shh. Then, shh. All right. The one who they are talking about, why he has to be punished? Huh?
The one who they're talking about?
The one they are talking about is a victim. Supposedly innocent. He didn't make a scene. If you got to a situation that people talk about you, check yourself. You're probably not 100% clean. The Gemara say, En ashan bli esh. There is no smoke unless if there is fire somewhere. Right? Which means that's an analogy that if somebody talks about you, you are guilty of something. Now you may say, but I can swear on my life and in the Torah that what they said about me was all a lie. I'm completely innocent. Maybe you're right. but you are guilty about something else. Because if you're 100% clean, you have a protection that you won't fall into the hands of this. Now I want to tell you something. A rabbi that everybody loves, then you know he's not a rabbi. He's not productive. A rabbi that everyone hates, then you know he's not a rabbi. And a rabbi that people love and some people hate, that's the best rabbi.
Why?
Now let me explain. If everybody liked that rabbi, that means he never said anything bad to anyone. He didn't come to this guy, hey Avi, why you live with Christine? Don't you know it's a big sin? What is going on with you? You don't want to wake up, you don't want to save your life, you don't want to establish a kosher family according to the Torah. When you speak to 10 Avis like this, 8 of them get angry. 8 of them get angry. 2 of them say, okay, Rabbi, you're right. It's about time I wake up. You save 2 souls. You're always going to have people who will speak against you and they get angry at you. That's a part of the job of being a rabbi. If everybody loves you, that means the Satan is not angry. He's not upset at you. You're not getting him nervous. The Satan's job is to make more and more Jews make sins. If the Satan did not make one enemy to you, that means you don't even disturb him, Bichlal. You can see, talk, you give lectures about Parashat HaShavua. Not one person in 20 years became better. And I know many, many speakers like this, grinding water for 20 years. You ask them after 20 years, with all due respect, yes, you taught Torah, it's a big mitzvah, very nice. Tell me, 20 years you saw 5,000 people, 10,000 people. Can you show one of them became a better Jew? Probably not. Why? Very soft. Nothing. No pressure. No nothing. To be too angry, all the time judgment. Also, it's not going to work. Because a person cannot tolerate only negative. So what's the solution? I want to read to you the words of the greatest rabbi lived in the last 100 years. It's good enough for you? Who is the greatest rabbi lived in the last 100 years in the whole world? The Chafetz Chaim. One rabbi had a dream. In his dream he saw that the Chafetz Chaim sits ba'olam haba in the level of the Tanaim. Hashem sent him to this generation to teach things that, you know, basically he was an expert in Lashon Hara, but it wasn't only that. The whole Mishnah Brura, it's Chafetz Chaim, Shulchan Aruch. Chafetz Chaim is very important. It's very important not only in the Ashkenazi world. He's accepted by Sfaradim, by everyone. Everyone knows Chafetz Chaim is it's a legend. Don't get me wrong, there were thousands of great rabbis that are just as good. Chafetz Chaim is a drop. He has a special place. What does the Chafetz Chaim say? Chafetz Chaim lived in Radin, and he gathered all the rabbis that live around Radin in Europe, and he made a convention. Now you have to remember, when Chafetz Chaim lived, we're talking about 100 years ago, it wasn't like today. You get into your Toyota Camry, and 2 hours later you come to the convention. Or you get a train or a plane, one way or the other, right? One way or the other, it's easy to come to conventions today, right? Whoever cannot see it has to go out. It's not a joke. Shiur Torah, it's very serious. You're not in school here that your math teacher turn around and you can play games with him. When you learn Torah, you have to be frozen and full concentration. Some people cannot keep full concentration. You cannot blame them. It's based on what they did up to now. That's the result. No problem. They go out 10 minutes. They relax. They come back in. But for sure, not to disturb other people when we learn Torah. Because Torah is no time to play games. Because this is the words of Hashem here. You know, we cannot play games with Torah. You have to know when you learn Torah, 10 minutes, but serious. 5 minutes, but serious. Half an hour, but serious. It's better half an hour serious than 50 hours not serious. Remember this. We're not talking history here, that you learn a little bit and you connect it together. This is the words of Hashem. So therefore, no text messages, no phone calls, not every second take your phone and play with that. If that's the way it is, don't come to the Shiurei Torah. It's better for you not to come. It's worse to come to Shiur Torah and sit there and play games than not to come at all. Because this is disgracing the name of Hashem. It's like mamash coming to a face of a person and spit in his face. Better to spit from far than to come right to his face and spit. Why? You come, you hear the words of Hashem, and what? What do you do? That's not for me. I'm not interested. The stupid phone is more important. Better not to come. Not to come. Say, it's no, headache, I'm helping my parents, I'm tired. No, you have some excuse. Sitting in a Shiur Torah and not taking it serious? That's already a very serious problem. So let's move on. So the Chafetz Chaim made a convention. What the convention is about? He gathered all the rabbis. Now remember, in his time, people came with horses and donkeys. That's what it was. Maybe trains also. But it was very difficult to gather people. But he gathered them from all over the area around Radin to tell them one thing. Guess what? This is his words. Now, I learned it already by heart because I was so happy that I found it. Took me years to find it. I wish I found it 10 years ago. Why I happy so much to find it? Because this is what I myself, the little puppet, I was saying it for the last 10, 12 years. And then I found that the Chafetz Chaim said what I said, word by word. So that means now it turns that I say what he said. But I didn't know about what he said. I just found out that 2 weeks ago. And this is what he said in that convention. It says like this. The soul of the Jewish nation is dead. What got it to die? Now he begins to explain to all the speakers, to all the rabbis. This is heads of congregations, head of communities, head Rashi Yeshivot. Important people. A Rosh Yeshiva of 100 years ago, it's like 100 together today in his knowledge and righteousness. He says, in the previous generations, all the great speakers, when they came to speak to the Jewish people, they spoke about one subject. Guess what? Heaven and hell. That's all around that. Yeah, of course, they speak about other things. But the topic of the lecture, you don't have to call. Rabbi, what's the topic for the flyer? Always the same topic. Heaven and hell. Reward and punishment. That was the whole lecture. Chafetz Chaim. Now, when the speaker changed their style, in his time, 100 years ago, if he would live today, he would pull his hair off. This is 100 years ago. He said, now, when the speaker stopped to talk about it, not only they're not helping the Jewish nation, they're damaging the Jewish nation. This is the words of Chafetz Chaim. Not only the lectures and their teaching is not productive at all. They're making a damage, which means it's better that they wouldn't teach at all. Why? Because when you teach and the people leave your lecture just as they came, with no conscious problem, is Mechalel Shabbat, he goes home smiling. What a beautiful lecture. What a great speaker. What great jokes. What charisma. Beloni, who cares about all this nonsense? Did you go home feeling guilty? I'm rebelling against my Hashem every day? Or you went home, smoke your cigar and watch your stupid television? If the lecture didn't do anything to your heart, didn't make you, excuse my language, almost making in your pants, that means the lecture wasn't productive. Because what is it like? Rashi writes, Rashi, I'm giving you the best names in history. Rashi writes, Hashem said, this is what it says in the Torah, Vayidaber Hashem el Moshe achare mot shnei bnei Aaron. Achare mot bnei Aaron. And Hashem spoke to Moshe after the death of the sons of Aaron. They ask a question, what does it mean after the death? We already know. It was obvious in that point of the Torah that they already died. Usually we never write an extra word in the Torah. Hashem never wrote one extra letter in the Torah. The Torah is divine, it's perfect. Every letter has a meaning in the Torah. Not every word, every letter. Every letter you can learn many halachot. For instance, kabed et avicha ve et imecha. What do you learn from the extra vav, ve'et imecha, what do you learn? That you're also your oldest brother. That's why. Because Hashem could write, respect your parents. Respect your father and mother. Not ve'et. What do you need ve'et? Kabed et avicha ve'imecha. Why ve'et? This is extra word. Right away, the Gemara begins an argument. Why? Why this word? This is the reason. This is the reason. This is the reason. Every word. All of a sudden, we find Hashem spoke to Moshe after the death of Bnei Aaron. Achare mot Bnei Aaron. Four extra words in the Torah. Four extra words. So Rashi writes, what is it like? A person comes to a doctor. Listen good, every word here, it's very heavy. A person comes to a doctor, and the doctor says to him, don't go to a place of tzinim, when it's cool over there. Don't eat cold things, and don't go to cold places. It happens today, every day. You go to your doctor, I don't feel good. I'm coughing, whatever. So doctor said, make sure not to be next to the air condition. And don't eat too cold things, the cold water, cold watermelon. Stay away from that for 3-4 days. Very good. So you know what's your cure. Okay. First doctor told him, don't eat cold and don't go to cold places. Then he went to a second doctor. The second doctor told him, don't eat cold and don't go to cold places like Reuven that did it and died because of it. That's the difference. Both doctors told him the same thing. Do not do XYZ. Do not do XYZ. Rashi writes, the first doctor was not productive. Did not help. The second doctor did the right job. Why? Yes. Because that's the only way human beings are moving towards the truth. Once in a lifetime, you find a kosher, pure soul of a person that as soon as he hears 1 hour of a lecture, beautiful lecture, gematria, things, codes, whatever, and run and say, I want to be tzaddik, I want to leave my job, I want to come to yeshiva, I want to divorce my goya. Right away, in 1 month, he become the Baba Sali. In my whole 15 years, I met 5 like this. That's all. Most of them, yeah, they wake up in the beginning, they see the light, wow, beautiful Torah. But beautiful Torah would last just for a week or two, that's it. You have to right away tell them, life is not a picnic, my friend. What do you think? You eat for free? You think you breathe for free? You think you drink for free? You think you have suit for free? You think you have a mansion for free? You think you have a wife for free? You think you have beautiful kids for free? The Gemara says, the Mishnah says, Rabbi Akiva says, this world is a supermarket. Makolet, grocery store. And the owner of the grocery store, who is he? HaKadosh Baruch Hu. And the owner of the grocery store, you take whatever you want from the grocery store. Right now you don't have to pay. Take bread, you take milk, you take cheese, you take whatever you take, he writes. One day he comes to collect. Who understand the analogy that Rabbi Akiva, well, Rabbi Akiva came to teach us Aleph Bet? In a Mishnah, that's what he has to say to tell us about this world is a grocery store. What does he want? To say, whatever you get easy, for free, don't ever make that mistake. Nothing is for free. Nothing and nothing is for free. You got a wife, there's a very big price to pay for her. You got kids, there's a huge price to pay for them. When are you going to pay for it? One day you live here, now Hashem will review your life. For your wife, you paid me. All your life you kept Shabbat. Very good. You have X amount of reward. All your life you gave tzedakot, you have X amount of reward. Now he puts all your reward in one side. Let's see what I gave you. Everything I gave you, I deduct from your reward. I owe you $100 billion. You got already $5 billion, now I owe you 95. Most of the people will begin to scream, no, no, if I knew it, I would not agree to get this Lexus. I didn't know. I would drive a little garbage car, 1970. That's not fair, I didn't know. Hashem would say, well, I didn't learn. You didn't learn that the more you enjoy here, the less you get later. The more you suffer here, the less you suffer later. The more you enjoy here, the less you enjoy later. Everything you get, the Gemara brings many examples. Rabbi Hanina ben Dosa was eating carobs, he have nothing to eat. The whole world gets plenty of food thanks to his righteousness, and he eats carobs. Carobs, it's like eating sticks. And one time, they got, his wife saw in a dream, I don't remember this Gemara many years, but it's a table that have three legs with gold, and already got one, and they showed her that this one came on the expense of the afterlife. We got the idea here. They got the idea here. What do you think? You get something for free? Nothing is for free. The more people are upsetting you, it takes away from your punishment. The more problems you have here, problem back, your back hurts, this hurts, your eyes, this, all kinds of problems, allergies. You're looking for a quarter for a payphone, and you found a dime, and you have to go back to your car, and you're looking now for a quarter, and you freeze in the meantime, it's wind. The 5 seconds that you are freezing already took away some of your sins. Someone spit in your face in front of hundreds. You did not make a beep. A million of your sins were erased right away. You answer him, not only your sin did not erase, you got an extra sin. Shomim cherpatam ve'enam neshivim. Always make sure that people insult you and you never insult others. Everything has a price. 7 years to live here in mistake, and in the end you have such a huge bill with interest and penalty. Where are we going to start? So the Chafetz Chaim writes, I'm encouraging all of you speakers to go back to the old good ways, heaven and hell. Today, if you just say the name hell in your lecture, 95% of the organization in America put an X on you for life. They'll never invite you to their seminars. They'll never invite you to their institution to talk. They will never allow to give your CDs in their place. Why? Because you read Psukim from the Torah or from the Gemara. Why? They are the new gods. They decide which parts of the Torah is kosher, which parts of the Torah is not kosher. And I always answer, I don't understand. If Hashem didn't want people to know about the punishments, why half of the Torah is full of descriptions about the punishment? Why they needed to write Arur, 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 Arur? Why they needed to write Chas v'Shalom that people will die young? Why they write about cancer? You know that the Torah is speaking about cancer? Did you know about it? There was no cancer in the time of the Torah. The Torah speak about cancer. Me'era. You know what Me'era with Aleph? I saw in one of the books that one of the reasons, I don't know if it's true or not, I'm just telling you to give you an idea. One of the reasons that many people get cancer in this generation is because people do not pray properly. Instead of saying Me'era with Hey, they say Me'era with Aleph. Because the Israeli accent of the last 50 years do not tell the difference between Aleph and Ayin or Aleph and Hey. In a Tfilat Shmona Esrei, many times it says Bimhera, which means fast. But people read it Bimera, Sfaradim, Ashkenazim, everyone. And it used to be that Sfaradim used to know how to tell the difference. But now the new generation, they also don't know. So they keep asking Hashem, send me cancer, cancer, cancer. Right? Bimera with Aleph, it's cancer. Me'era with Aleph, it's cancer. Bimera, Me'era, send me Me'era, send me Me'era. That's maybe one, Chas v'Shalom, I hope it's wrong. One of the rabbis wrote it in his book. You got it? What's going on here? So, you know, it's scary, mamash scary. It says in the Torah, Me'era. It says the word Me'era in the Torah, Mam'eret. This is Mam'ir. Mam'ir means cancer. There's a growth that is cancer, a growth that is not cancer. Torah speaks about it. The Torah speaks about the sicknesses that were not in the time of Egypt. The Torah say, Chas v'Shalom, if you go against me, there's going to be a price to pay. Now you have to remember, a person that becomes sick, he thinks, why I deserve it? Where is the justice? Where is the mercy of God? But really, if you have a moment to review his entire life, to review his entire life, not only he deserved it, not only he deserved it, he didn't get 1% of what he really deserved. And I'm talking, all of us include myself. I'm not excluding myself. If we go for what the good we do, and all the bad that we do, and we put it on a scale, we won't know where to hide. 750 years ago, there was a rabbi that if we live a million years, we won't have enough mitzvot like he had. His name was Rabbeinu Nisim. His interpretation on the Talmud is in the end of the Gemara. The Ran, Rabbeinu Nisim, is one of the most important rabbis in a generation that came after the Rambam, the Ramban. So guess what? Rabbeinu Nisim says, if we have a Sidur, Dina, יש לך Sidur פה של יום כיפור? Saradi, Tavi. Rabbeinu Nisim says,
Here.
Okay, forget about it. No. Rabbeinu Nisim says, no, he doesn't know what the Sidur is. Forget about it. No. Okay, no. Rabbeinu Nisim writes a big vidui. Confession. Every day we have short confessions. We say, I don't know, 20, 30 different kinds of sins that we do every day. Atati, we hit the heart. Why we hit the heart? Because this is where the evil inclination is. The Yetzer Hara. So we go Chatati, Aviti, Pashati. That's what we do every day. But in Yom Kippur, he wrote a special, very long confession with more details. In the end of his confession, he says something that if a person has 1% fear from God, not 100%, 1% fear from God, 1%. It's a big mitzvah to have fear from God. The more fear you have, the more God loves you. Because fear and respect go together. That's the way the world is. Fear and respect. Shlomo HaMelech wrote, Ashrei Adam Mefached Tamid. Person that fear Hashem, the more he fear him, the less sins he make. So right away, he's more righteous. Person who doesn't care, he does everything. Hashem. Olam Haba. Don't believe in this. Hashem will have mercy on me. Don't worry. A person like this will never progress. Never. Always stay in his level or worse. So this is what he writes. He writes like this. It says, if I'm going to reveal all my sins, I want to repeat, this is a person that if he would come for 1 hour here to Queens, New York, 1 hour to one of the synagogue, and if people would see who he is, everyone would see him become religious that second, not tomorrow, that second, just from seeing him, from looking in his face. This is an angel. Now we're not talking just another righteous person. It's a big chacham. This is what he wrote. About himself. What did he write? It says like this. Im avo lefaret et chata'ai, if I'm going to reveal my sins, azman ichle, the time will end. If I'm going to reveal all my sins, the time in this earth will end. And I will not finish to say the least. Got what I say to you now? How many years? 6,000 years this world is. Right? He lived 750 years ago. So he knew in his time that until Mashiach come, we're talking almost 1,000 years from his time. If 1,000 years from morning to night, I'm going to continue to reveal my sins, time will end. And I will not finish the list, he says. When I read it for the first time in my life, believe me, I was very close from fainting. Why? Because right away I knew, I learned Gemara, so I knew who he is. A little bit I know who he is, a little bit. When I read that such a holy person, this is what he feels. Because remember, a person won't write a lie in front of Hashem with this level. They don't say a lie in a whole life, these people. If he wrote it, that means he feels like this. If he feels like this, what are we going to say? Why he is shaking and we are dancing? Why? The dumbest you are, the dumber you are, the more smile you have. That's what my father once told me when I was a kid. Stupidity, there's no concern about. Nothing to worry about. The smarter you are, the worse you are. When I was a kid, I had a cousin. He came from a rich family, and I came with a middle class and even lower family. My father was working in a factory. His father was an owner of businesses. And he was a brave guy, and I was a coward. That's how it was in a family. Every time, his father was a very, very proud person. We're not talking religious people here, so don't expect too much from him. Every time there was something in the neighborhood with the kids, his son was the hero. He wanted to jump from the second floor, like Tarzan. He jumped, he climbs on fences, in a pool, since he's a little kid, not even in first grade, he throw him from the rocks, from the cliffs, all the way down to the deep water. And me, afraid to jump into the deep water, not jumping on fence, not climbing on a tree, a coward. So all the years he was telling my mother, your son is a coward. My son is a macho. Today when I think about it, I don't know if to cry or to laugh. But the interesting thing here, that at one point in my life when I started to get a little bit sechel, I told my mother, a stupid person does all these things. A smart person doesn't do it. This is a proof, because my parents used to get offended that he showed their son he's a coward, he's not brave, he doesn't jump from the cliff, from the fence, this, that. And so I said, the opposite. Smart person doesn't jump, go on trees, taking risks. We used to drive in Sodom and Gomorrah around, you know, this very, very dangerous place. If you sit in his car, you lose 10 years of your life. You get gray hair, how he was driving. One lane to each side, big trucks coming. He goes, go. A second before he goes in. One time, sitting in a car in the back, we almost crashing into the truck. There was not time to go. You know, sometimes people don't care. They let you get killed. They speed that you won't go back in. They don't care. They kill 4 people. As long as you don't press on their ego. Why? You're passing me like this? I'll speed that you get stuck and you don't have room to come back. Then you get killed. This is how cruel people can be. For a matter of ego, they let you die. Guess what happened to us? He went off the road. Mamash, half a second from such a horrible death. He went to the other side of the road. This is the brave guy. This is a fool, not a brave guy. This is not what Hashem is interested. Hashem says, I'm not interested in the strength of a horse. Lo b'shokeh, lo b'shokeh asus. I'm not interested in the muscle of a man. I'm not interested in the strength of the horse. I'm interested in a person who follow me and learn my ways, that he can save himself from the judgment, that I should reward him as I want. That's what I really want. The prophet Yechezkel writes that Hashem says, I'm not interested to kill the dead. There's a dead person. I'm not interested to kill him. What do you mean? He's dead already. How can you kill a dead person? But this is a divine language. It's no mistakes. I'm not interested to kill the dead. Rather, I'm interested that he will repent from his bad way, that he should live. Again, simple English. Hashem say, there is a dead person here. I don't want to kill him. He's dead already. I don't want to kill him. I prefer that he make tshuva, make repentance, that he should live. Who is a clever guy here can tell me what is the conclusion from this verse in the Tanakh? What did you learn from this verse that I just said? I repeat for the third time. Be'ivrit. Chai Hashem. Hashem says, I swear on my name. I'm not interested in the death of the dead. Rather, I'm interested that he return back from his bad way, that he should live. If I would be close to you, I would kiss you. So, Baruch Hashem, one guy from so many people, he got the answer. Yes. He say a person that is not following the ways of Hashem and keeping Torah and mitzvot every day, not once a year when his father has yahrzeit, every day, in the eyes of God, is 100% considered like a dead person. Better to be dead than to be alive and do and make sins. What's better? To live 70 years full of sins or to die in 20? If a person does 70 years mistakes, one sin after the other, when he comes to Hashem when he's 7 years old, first thing he will complain about, so why didn't you keep me so long in this world? Why didn't you kill me when I was 18? Why didn't you kill me in my bar mitzvah? You make me choke on the burekas. Why did you keep me 7 years? I'm angry. I'm upset. Of course, you won't have the guts to make a beep. I'm just telling you, hypothetically speaking. Why? It's not fair. You should have killed me when I was 13. What would be the answer? Why do you think I created you to begin with? To give you X amount of years to test you. If every person comes to the test and see it, after a minute the teacher throw him out of the class, what is he going to say in the end? He didn't give me a chance to pass. I gave you a chance to pass. You know, one very famous claim wicked people do. They always, all wicked people say the same thing. I ask Hashem to make me? It's his problem. I'm not interested to be religious. I'm not interested to be religious. I didn't ask you to make me. Don't bother me. If I had a way to ask from you, to create me, and then now you're judging me, then I understand. But since I didn't ask you, what do you want from me? Leave me alone. It's better off. You wouldn't create me. Right? Good point, no? The wicked people love to wave with this flag. So what's the answer? I'll give you a story you understand. Two brothers marry two sisters. Who are the two brothers? One of them is blind, one of them is deaf. Bare defect. One of them never heard voice, one of them never saw anything. It was very difficult to marry them. There was two sisters from a family, you know. One of them has a problem. She doesn't stop cursing for a minute. Very angry woman, all day scream and curse. Nobody wants to even go near her, and shiduchim, she's finished. Nobody. The other ones, she's such an ugly woman that from the time of the creation of the world, nobody ever saw such a thing. Nobody wants to marry her, miskena, you know. No, what can she do? One guy said, oh, I have a perfect match for your two sons. Give the deaf to the one who cares all day. Perfect match. And give the ugly to the blind. And everything will be perfect. Ah, the parents were very happy. They gave money. They make beautiful wedding. Fine. 20 people fainted in a wedding from her curses, 40 from her ugliness. Baruch Hashem, the wedding, somehow they made it. Atzala, 20 ambulance in each wedding. No, Baruch Hashem. In the end, now they married, 10 years, they're happily married. One time, a famous doctor came to town. The doctor put an ad, I can cure blind people, I can cure deaf people. Right away, the father ran. Sons, your misery is about to end. Come to this doctor. Right away, the doctor checked the ears. I said, no problem. I'll fix it. The other one, he checked his eyes. No problem. Tomorrow, after the surgery, you already see. That reminds me, don't worry, I'll finish the story. But I want to push something here. About 6 years ago, five, 6 years ago, I got a phone call from someone who knows me, if I can host a father and son, if I can host a father and son to be by me for a few days, from Wednesday to Monday to Sunday, something like that. Why? They come from Israel, they live in Kiryat Sefer. Their father is a rabbi in Yeshiva, in Kollel, and his son has a growth inside his eye. 12, 11 years old, the boy. He has a growth not cancer, but growth that grows every month, grows a little more and more, and he became blind in one eye. And soon, you know, who knows what's going to be, and they need a very sophisticated surgery. Here in Philadelphia, there's an eye center. Here, from all over the world, people come, the best doctors here in Philadelphia. So from Israel, they're sending him here to an expert. But they, you know, they need a few days to be here until they go to Philadelphia. So I say, of course, let them come. Here I'm telling you the name of the guy. You can go and check. Until this moment, he lives in Kiryat Sefer. His name is Rabbi Neri Giat. Yebed Night Rabbi, wonderful person, with nice, great midot, fantastic human being. He has many kids, Bli Ainara, and this boy, Avraham his name, the boy, blind in one eye. They come to me, they sit on a Shabbos table, my chevruta, Rabbi Asher Schwartz, in those days used to be my chevruta, it's a big Talmid Chacham, and Ashkenazi Rav is older than me a lot, but in Shabbat, with me and him, we don't need invitation. He just show up. He showed up, he comes, he goes to the library, he goes to the shul, he's next to me, he comes in. He walk into the table. He already davenets, so for him, he already finished eating, everything. He just come to talk. He likes to come, talk divrei Torah on Shabbat. So he sits on the table, we're eating in the middle of the meal. He sits in front of this boy and his father, and he doesn't know who they are. First time he sees that. I didn't say anything to him. Yeah, Rabbi Schwartz sits here, the father and the son here, and this other guest. He comes and says, you know, I'm davening in this minyan, and there's a doctor over there. He told me, you should know, you should tell all your people, he said to me, that people who have cancer, they should not eat sugar. It makes the cancer grow a lot faster. And he begins to tell me about eyes, about the eyes. Sugar is not good for people. Now he begins to talk about eyes, people who have problems with their eyes. And this is the father and the son sitting right there. And then he talks about that one of the best doctors in the world is davening with him in a minyan, and he's telling him things about the eyes. So I say, oh, Baruch Hashem from Shamayim, you came. This is the reason they came here. You know, maybe you make a meeting. They have all the papers from the hospital in Israel. Maybe you introduce them. They send them to a specific doctor in Philadelphia. The next day he took them. The doctor looked at everything and said, oh, they send you to the best doctor in the world for it. I cannot help you in anything more than him. Go to him. The insurance in Israel cover it. You're all set. But he made him relax because he was very worried, his father. No. But they went there. They wanted hundreds of thousands of dollars. The Israeli insurance didn't want to pay it. So they went back home, and the kid is still blind. Then they send them to Liverpool in England. Over there it's much cheaper, maybe $100,000. It will be the whole operation and everything and recovery. Over there they check, they say it's too late, there's not that much we can do. They send them back to Israel, and another year went by. One morning, Thursday morning, I go to do kniot for Shabbat. I go to Shabbat and tell you in details how everything went in the right order. I stand in Costco in a store with my card, looking in the list. Then I get a phone call. I don't recognize, I don't know the number. I pick up the phone, say, who is this? Neri Giat. Oh, how are you? How is Avraham? I called to give you very good news. I say, what? My son Avraham, his vision came back to his eye. I said to him, what? Oh, you did a surgery? He said, no, he's telling me the whole story, what happened in Liverpool, they couldn't help. So I said, so what happened? He said, you'll never believe in a million years what happened. Ay, 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 ay. You'll never believe. He said, he comes to me 2 weeks ago. He said, you know, I'm beginning to lose my vision in my other eye. Not growth, glasses. You know, one eye works very hard in a class, whatever. So now he needs glasses. One eye doesn't see at all. He needs glasses in the other eye, because now when you have one eye and you don't see good, it's a problem. So they took him to a place. So, you know, they asked him, what do you prefer, to have contact lens or glasses? You know, glasses, one glass will be regular. Just glass, The other one will be a lens. So he said, what do you prefer? He said, I prefer to have a lens.
Contact?
Yeah, contact lens. Why? I don't want to go with glasses to school. He's a kid, 12. By now he was maybe 13, 14, I don't know exactly. So they went there, they checked his eyes, and they made him a contact lens. A week later, when he came, when he was ready, the nurse was bringing him into the room. She explained to him how to use it. And she came, open your eye. She put it in the wrong eye. Then he opened up the eye. He's seen both eyes. One eye not so straight, not so good, because he needs glasses. Then he started to see in his eye. Regular contact lens. How much? $100. He put the contact lens in. He opened up his eyes. He began to see. I told him, are you serious? What are you telling me? He said, I know, nobody can believe such a thing. The best doctors in the world, in Israel, in Philadelphia, in Liverpool. When Hashem doesn't want the boy to see X amount of time, nothing will help. When the decree was dismissed, $100. Right away they make him two contact lens, today bli ayin hara, may he see for the rest of his life. Everything is gone. No? 200,000, 300,000. That's it. To show you what's going on here. Yes, gidul. Yes, the growth. That's it. Yes, a little growth inside. That's it. He sees. You understand what's happening? What happened when he start losing his vision? They thought, I guess it's because of the growth. But in the end, maybe he didn't have, I don't know. I'm not a doctor. I cannot explain what happened. The conversation was maybe 2-3 minutes. Not even. He called from Israel. He just say, I want to thank you again for the hospitality. We took him to the lake. We wanted to make the boy happy, you know. When we see a boy in such situation, at least you want to contribute something. So we go back to our story that you already forgot about. So now the two brothers are coming to a surgery. They need a surgery. They need. The guy opens up his eyes. The other guy begins to hear. They run home quickly to tell their wives that their life is changing. The guy comes to the neighborhood, Imach Shimo, where is he? The dog, I'll kill him. I said, who is it? I didn't know I live in such a bad neighborhood. The closer he gets to his apartment, oh my God, no, it's coming from the right direction. What? He opens the door, where are you? So, what are you doing? She got nervous. What, you hear me? Yeah, I'm after the surgery. As soon as he saw that, right away, Rabbi, get, I don't want to talk about, get right away. My wife cares such curses, religious woman like this. Care, my head get. No, the other guy comes home, comes in, he says, hi, do you know where is Mrs. Cohen? I'm Mrs. Cohen. What's wrong with you? You are my wife. Oops. Fainted. That's it. Before he even got up from his fainting, the get was already arranged. So both of them got divorced. Guess what they do now? They decided to sue the doctor. The poor doctor was visiting in town. They took him to court. So in court, they say, we want 10 million, 20 million.
The wives.
No, the man, not the wife. The wife is out of the picture already, got a get. So now they come, the two brothers, they sue the doctor for ruining their life. So they said to the judge, listen, my life was perfect until he came to town. From now on, look what happened. I got divorced, this problem. So the judge said to the doctor, I understand your point. You wanted to do good. But you know, according to the Torah, if you want to do good and you make a damage, he's still guilty, you know. It's a problem. But since you didn't do it on purpose, we have to find a way that both sides will be happy. So I have a solution, the judge says. Take them tomorrow morning back to the clinic in a hospital, make the deaf one deaf again, and make the blind one blind again, and that will be the verdict. So they started to scream, no! What kind of judge you are? What is this? I don't want to be blind. The other one, you crazy? Finally I hear you. You want me to be deaf again? So the judge say, I didn't want you to make me here. I didn't want you to make me able to see, huh? But now, when I want to take it away from you, you begin to scream, no! This is us. All these wicked people that say, I didn't want you to make me. You made me, it's your problem. Well, you want me to keep mitzvot? Forget it, I'm not interested. When a person is about to die, no, no, God, no, I don't want to die, please. Here, I retain him all day, give me another chance. No, he doesn't, not when he die, when the IRS send him a letter. Like this, he cannot hold it. To die? I saw a big grave, dying from cancer in York Hospital, in Manhattan. Every person who walked into his room, he was begging him with tears to give him a bracha, blessing. Please, please, come, you, come. Mommy, I'm the driver. Come, give me a blessing. He said, so the other person asked him, Kvod Harav, why you ask from every person you see a bracha? So he said, I don't know who these people are. How do I know? Maybe he has one big mitzvah. Maybe he's important in Shamayim. Why do I have to lose? The more blessing I get from people, maybe one of them will save me. He was so worried to die. You should see how he was worried. And believe me, this is a person, if we are not worried, he for sure doesn't have what to worry about. He was okay. Baruch Hashem, he has a lot of zchuyot. But he was shaking. I'm telling you. I mean, I was embarrassed to stand there. Believe me, I couldn't stand there for more than a few minutes. Try to go out and come in and out from the situation. He was holding the hand of the Rav that came with me. We came I brought a big Rav to visit him. That's how I got to that situation. And he was begging this big Rav, I don't want you to give me a bracha. I want you to decree, to make a gzerah that I'll get out of here. So that rabbi was telling him, who am I? Listen, there's no time for modesty right now, for being humbled. Give him, make a decree. What do you have to lose? Maybe get out of there. In the end, he passed away. But this is it. Just to show you how a person, when the time comes, all these bombastic speeches. Why did he make me? Give him, take away 10 minutes of his life. He's already crazy. Now he say, why did you make me? Do you know one person who murders crazy people or people in deep depression? They're not controlling their minds anymore. But a normal person, what normal person wants to die? People in Auschwitz, in a war situation, were fighting not to die. Eating pills of potatoes. Hard to believe. So the Torah says like this. Arur asher lo yakim et divrei haTorah hazot ve'amar kol ha'am amen. I started to ask, is any way that we can go to a Jew and we should not ask him from giving tzedakah? And this is the answer, and maybe we should finish with this. It says like this. If you come to a person and tell him, listen, my job is to make balei tshuva, to take not religious Jews, and convince them, to prove to them that Torah is divine, to show them that the world is based on reward and punishment, there's afterlife, wake up before it's too late. Usually it works, but not always. Some people see the truth, say everything, been proven, I'm not asking no doubts, but I'm happy the way I am, I'm not interested to change. It's too much for me, my wife won't agree, I have kids, now I'm going to lose my family, everyone has excuses. My business work on Shabbat, it's the busiest day of the week, this, my parents. No, excuses, Baruch Hashem, there are plenty. If I come to a guy that is wealthy, and I tell him, I want you to give $1,000 that I can make 1,000 DVDs, 4 hours each, full seminars, and we want to give them in a concert here, which there's 2,000 or 3,000 not religious Jews go every night when they have the concert, especially in the summer. We have volunteers, they go with boxes. Everyone who comes out of the concert, earring, ponytail, they give him a CD, $1, they give him. Sometimes they give him $3, depending on the budget. What happened to these people? Probably 20-30% of them, a minute later, throw it to the garbage. But the people have the nature of curiosity. Most people are curious to see at least 5 minutes, what's in it. The first 5 minutes are already very good. Because I'm saying in a video many, many questions about life, and every normal person is bothering him this question. Who made this world? God exists? The Torah is divine? Not divine? Is there life after life? What's the difference between all the religions? These are already questions that most normal people think about. Mm-hmm. So the first 5 minutes is already tempting them to see the rest. Those who threw it out, what can you do? Those who watch, most likely will finish to watch. Doesn't mean they become religious. Some of them become 10% religious. Some of them 50%. Some of them 100%. And some of them do not become religious. So worse comes to worse, they heard 4 hours of Torah. How many mitzvot is 4 hours of Torah? How many mitzvot? Each minute, it's 200 words. Multiply by 5 letters in the average word is 1,000 mitzvot a minute. 1 hour, it's 60,000 mitzvot. 4 hours, it's 240,000 mitzvot for $1. Goes to your account, the person who gave the thousand DVDs. So, let's say 700 people watch that. 700, 500, whatever. We don't know exactly the numbers. 500 watched it. 500 times 250,000 mitzvot. More than you're going to do not in all your life, in all your gilgulim together. For how long? For how much? For $1. Multiply by 1,000. For, you know, another 1,000 and another 1,000. You can add up trillions and billions of mitzvot. Most people, believe it or not, they may have $100 million, $500 million, $1 billion. A person that they put him in the news that he worth minimum $4 billion, promised me $10,000 a month to make it, to do it. $10,000 for month for him is 1 hour work, maximum. He makes it in an hour, in a whole month, 1 hour. Nah, he makes a lot more than that. But let's say an hour of his month. To get to 10,000 not religious Jews every month, he has to donate an hour of his time, let's say. He gave for the first month and stopped. Right away stopped. Most of the people, they give ridiculous checks, the rich ones, most of them. Now, this is exactly what the Torah spoke about. If you come to a Jew and you know he's stingy, it's better not to ask from him any kind of donations to help teaching Torah to others. You can ask him for the synagogue, he said, no, fine. Wait. You ask him to help a poor family, he say, no, fine. It's all a problem, don't get me wrong. Every tzedakah that you have an opportunity to give and you missed it, believe me, you're going to cry for it. But when it comes to make Baalei Tshuva, you're going to be very, very, very careful not to come to a person directly. And I'm telling you this, for 15 years, I never came to a person with a demand or a request just because of this. I speak in general. Whoever understands the hint, fine. Doesn't understand, it's his problem. But I don't come to him. The same thing, you're not allowed to invite a person to a brit. You're not allowed to give invitation. You're allowed to announce there's a brit tomorrow morning. Why? I'm inviting you here, an invitation. No. If he doesn't come to a brit after he was specifically invited, it's a big problem. Don't invite. Just announce. Put a sign in a synagogue. Everyone should know there's a brit in that day. Over here, if I come to him and I say, give me $1,000. I want to make 1,000 CDs. I need 5,000 CDs. Give it to me. What happened? If he says no, right away, he becomes arur. The worst thing in the Torah, because this is what the Torah say. Arur asher lo yakim et divrei Torah hazot. Someone who doesn't publish my Torah is cursed immediately. And I don't want to tell you what does it mean to be arur, believe me. If you know what the meaning of the word arur, it's the worst thing. Yes.
Let's say the person asked for tzedakah from Ploni, but not for himself, for someone.
Yeah.
And that person denied the tzedakah. She says that she cannot give, or she has her own stories.
Right.
Now, in what situation the person who are asking the tzedakah in this case, but it's not for herself, it's for other people.
She has the mitzvah that she did what needs to be done, and the person that didn't do it lost the potential reward. That's it.
Can I tell you something? I had a situation, I asked a woman for tzedakah for a very sick person with a disease.
Yeah.
And I was collecting money. And the lady, young woman, very wealthy woman, living in $2 million house, she is denying the tzedakah. She said, oh, I'm sorry, I cannot give you $100. $100 for a cancer patient. And she said, I cannot give you my husband's gifts to the his rebbe, his shul.
Right.
And we don't have the express. But $100. Two weeks later, I heard that she has a daughter, 12-year-old girl, right before bat mitzvah, and terrible disease. She is losing the hair bunches and bunches. They don't know what to do with her.
That's how it usually is. What do you think? No, we don't need more questions. We got the point. The point is very simple. When you don't care about others, Hashem don't care about you. That's a very obvious rule. If Hashem gives you an opportunity to help others and you don't care about them, even if you do not cry with everyone about the destruction of Beit HaMikdash, I'm not asking too much, to come one day here on Tisha B'Av for an hour and sit on the floor and cry, that's it. Once a year, 1 hour. It's an obligation. And you say, I gotta go to work. I'm on the way to the beach. My vacation, my plan is leaving 11 o'clock, whatever. I don't want to participate with this, crying, sitting on the benches on the floor. So, somebody like this, what's his punishment? How to believe? What? When Hashem will rebuild Yerushalayim in the third temple, which is the final temple when Mashiach comes, he will not see it. Measure for measure. You didn't cry for the destruction of my two temples? You won't see the permanent temple that will be built. You won't see it, measure for measure. You can be in heaven, maybe. Maybe you have a lot of mitzvot, Shomer Shabbat, giving tzedakah, having yeshivot, helping orphans, making billions of mitzvot. I'm not saying, there's no contradiction. But when the time of Beit HaMikdash will come, it's a big bonus to be there, to see it. You cannot be there. And that's a big thing. Why? You see what's going on here. You see, someone is drowning. I'm not talking now that you're suspecting that the guy is a crook. There's rumors. You don't know. That's, at least you have an excuse. We are talking now, like she said, there is a famous cancer patient. And you have millions of dollars. Assume that story is true. Not everyone who lives in a nice house has millions of dollars. Sure. There are people who live in houses that are worth a lot and they don't have money for... They get Tom Cheshabes. Tom Cheshabes they get. I'm telling you, I know from a fact. They get for the holidays, they get boxes. They used to have money. One bad transaction, they got wiped out. You know how many people lost all their money by Madoff? Thousands of families that were very wealthy, 10 million, 20 million, 50 million, each one of them invested by him because it's like a drug. You see that you make 12% tax-free on your money, then you say, what a fool I am. Every penny I make, right away I give him. Right away, I don't keep a penny by me. And then one day, the Gemara asked never to put all your eggs in one basket. And in the end, they got wiped out. I know a family that I made a meshiduch with a big Talmid Chacham, a guy that was 18, 19 years old, finished the Shas already 3 times. I don't know if there's anybody else in the world that was like him. 3 times, twice Bavli, once Yerushalmi. 3 times in age 19. I got him with this girl. And of course, they made an arrangement that the family will support him for 5 years, 7 years, whatever the case was. A few months later, and this is generous people. Everyone who knock on their door, strangers, they give always nice tzedakot. All of a sudden, the father of the boy told me, just by the way, you should know, they stopped giving my son the money. I said, huh? I said, yeah, they're not giving. And we're embarrassed to talk about it, but that's it. They gave for almost a year and they stopped. When I saw that, I started to follow this family to see, and I really saw that they got rid of the maid, they got rid of one car, they live in a very, very lower, much lower lifestyle. And then another investigation, and here and here, and Hashem got me the answer. They lost all their savings. And you know how many thousands of families like this you have? Thousands of families. So that's because he lives in a nice house, maybe he paid it off, and the good days when he had millions, and now he doesn't have any more to live, to pay heat. I give you an example. I know people that cannot put heat in a house because it's more than $1,000 a month the bill. And I know family that have 3 mansions, 3 big houses, one in somewhere in New York, one in Long Island, and one in Manhattan. Very expensive houses, 10 million and up each house. And they keep the heat on AD on each one of the 3 houses. They only in one house at a time, so the other 2 houses, a whole month straight. It's probably thousands of dollars to heat such a mansion. So they probably spend more than $10,000 a month just on heat, on houses that are not even there. They go on vacations, they go overseas, and not to talk about the servants that are there, they're living there, so they get full salary, the driver is still is their driver, they're not firing him. So they're paying fortune for luxury that is completely not necessary. When there are families who have children freezing in the house, they try to manage with blankets, and they cannot put the heat just not to freeze. And this is what's going on. And then the rich people, instead of making their belly bigger and bigger, and help somebody else, they don't care. They don't care. And that's what happens. That's why it's very dangerous. If there is any chance, that this person will say no, right away you make him curse. It's better not to try. Very dangerous. Ma, arur asher lo yakim et divrei Torah hazot. Arur. Arur. You know, there was a Rebbe from Vishnitz for a few generations ago in Europe, before they came to America and to Israel. And one time, in the middle of Shabbat, he comes Friday night, Erev Shabbat, he said to his gabbai, to his assistant, I want you to take me to a house of this person. The gabbai didn't understand. This person wasn't a Hasid Vishnitz. Why on Friday night the Rebbe wants to walk all the way to that house? So I'm not asking questions. Let's walk. We walk together. They come, knock on the door. This person is an owner of a big bank in Europe. Owner of a bank. Big rich guy. So they knock on the door, you see the Vishnitz Rebbe come to his house. Now he knows he doesn't come for tzedakah, it's Friday night. So he didn't get nervous. So, Rabbi, you coming to my house, please, have a seat, right away the servants, put table. The Rebbe sits on the table, 10 minutes, 20 minutes, and don't talk. Rabbi, something happened? Can I help you? What's the point of the visit? I never heard you, you never came to my house. Can I do something for you? The food is glatt kosher. He doesn't know what to say. The gabbai sits here. The rabbi sits here. The owner of the house sits here. And for half an hour, he doesn't make a beep. After half an hour, the rich guy called the gabbai, the assistant, to another room. He said, can I talk to you? He said, listen, what's going on here? I'm very embarrassed. Why did the rabbi come here and sit here? I'm getting very nervous. Did he see something in the house? Maybe something's supposed to happen, so he comes to protect me. He doesn't know what to think. So the gabbai say, I'm with him 20 years, and I never saw such a strange behaving ever. So he says, so what should I do? Should I ask him? He says, I don't know what he's doing. I promise you, I don't know. I don't know why he told me to come here. They went back, another half an hour, he sits like this. Then the rich guy says, Rabbi, please, that cannot go on like this. I need you to tell me why you came here. Why are you not talking? So the rabbi told him, there is a mitzvah in the Torah, not to say something, knowing the person will not hear anyway. So I came to do this mitzvah this Erev Shabbos. So he told him, what do you mean? He said, if I was in my house, and I wouldn't come and sit next to you, I cannot talk to you from my house. So I cannot do this mitzvah. The mitzvah is to sit next to you, I'm able to tell you, and I'm holding myself not to say. And soon I'm going to leave, and I kept that mitzvah. Oh, this rich guy became crazy now. He said, what is it that I'm not going to say? What is it I'm not going to do? He said, no, I'm not saying. I know you're not going to do, so what's the point? I just came to be here, I'm leaving, goodbye. He held his hand, oh, Rabbi, you cannot leave me like this. Say, I'm begging you, say. He say, it came to my attention that on Tuesday, this coming Tuesday, a house in that street that belongs to that widow, that her husband died and left her with 10 kids, you gave her a mortgage, your bank, and she couldn't pay because her husband died. And it came to my attention that on this Tuesday you're throwing her to the street with her 10 kids, and you're selling the house in the auction. And I came here to ask from you, how can you do such a thing? That house would make you richer than what you are. You own so much. You're throwing a widow. What about what Hashem say in the Torah? That it's a widow. It's our brother, our sister. And I came to do that mitzvah, but I know you won't listen. But you now force me to talk. I lost my mitzvah. I said, Rabbi, how can you ask from me such a thing? They're not talking about $1,000 a year. It's a whole mortgage. I have to support her. Plus, I have partners in the bank, you know. Yeah, I'm the chief, but I have partners under me. So you see, I know what I'm talking about. I know you're not going to hear. Now you took away my mitzvah, because I said, you're better off, you won't. Tuesday, everything is set in the auction. That person ran, the owner of the bank ran to the auction and say, and dismissed it in the last minute. And say, we got into an arrangement with the borrower, and he kept her in the house. So you see, for 3 days, it was killing him, until he agreed. I had a very similar case to this. Very similar. It came to my attention that a woman that got divorced from her husband because he wasn't religious, and she was very religious, and they have kids. And now since she separated from him, he gives her a little money every month. It's not enough. And in her divorce situation, she had a lawyer, a real big shot lawyer, and it cost a lot of money to get divorced. A lot of money. When you have to split property, it costs a lot of money. So she owed him a lot of money. We're talking tens of thousands of dollars. So I had an idea to go to his office and convince him to waive this huge debt, to waive it completely. Or, at the minimum, to give her such a payment plan of, who knows, 10 years that she give, I don't know, $200 a month, until one day he gets whatever he deserved. I went to his office. He never had, in all his career, he never had such a thing, that someone comes to him. So I came to him, I say, he doesn't know who I am. If I come as just a regular person, he'll tell me, are you dreaming to waive such a fee? What are you talking about? You know, so I had to impress him a little bit, to make it worth for him to talk to me. So I gave him my card. You know, he reads, he sees the card. I say, if you ever have time, Hashem helped me that he opened up a spiritual conversation. He's a Shomer Shabbos, without a kippah in his office. He said something right away, and I right away continue from what he said. Mamash perfect. He gave me the beginning. And I started to tell him, you know. And then I told him, this is what I want from you. He didn't know if to cry or to smile. He said, to waive the whole lesson. I'm not running after her. I'm not sending collection. Don't worry. You know, I understand that she doesn't have. She can pay a little at a time. I said to him, listen, forget about her. You're giving me donation. Forget about her. You think that you participate in my kiruv work. You understand what kiruv is, right? I say, yes. I say, I'm giving you a gold mine. Huh? Hashem will decide how much from my work will come to you. He looks, wow, it's a very tempting offer. No, after all this, he said, okay, can you forgive us? He tells the woman, can you forgive us? He said, yeah. He said to him another half an hour. He said, yeah, you know, but it's my partner, my wife, this, that, that. I said, don't worry, I'm sure you're going to make the right decision. I said to him, you're charging hundreds of dollars an hour. If she's going to send you $200-$300 a month, that's not going to make you happy. Come on, let's talk honest. Another, it's not even an hour of your man. This is what, but at least you did a great mitzvah. She's like a widow. Ah, she's going to pay such an amount. You know what she makes, this, that. He started, so he said, okay, give me until Sunday. Monday he called. He said, okay, so the debt was reduced to 20,000. He took 80% of the amount almost. So I told him, come on, you almost did the whole thing. What? He said, no, that's what my wife approved. In America, the wife is the boss. I say, you know what? We made Baruch Hashem a very good step forward. Take another 4 days. Think about it. You come with the right. He said, okay. Give me another 4 days to digest. Step by step. Same thing. You don't come to tell a person, God forbid, if somebody had an accident, he's dear. You don't tell him right away. So you say, this person had an accident and he's in the hospital. You don't say right away. What happened to him? We don't know yet. We're hoping for good. First, he digests now that something happened. And an hour later you tell him a little more until he digests it. Sometimes if you give too much, it's like giving too much drug in 1 second, the person becomes crazy for the rest of his life. Mental breakdown. And I will finish with one last thing. When I was a soldier, I didn't get the phone call yet. Now we are in that second period. Maybe your zchut that you listen to that story will help. Be'ezrat Hashem. Now listen good. When I was a soldier, the first time I went to my base, I was in the Air Force, all the way in the north, in a desert somewhere, under the ground. So when I first time they took me to the base, I was falling asleep in a bus. The bus take all the soldiers from Tel Aviv all the way to the south in Israel, where the deserts are. So I started to doze a little bit, you know, I'm falling asleep. But I remember that the bus from the main road, it got to an intersection somewhere in a desert, and he made a turn, and from that moment we got to the base. But I didn't realize that when he made a turn, I really fell asleep completely. And I didn't realize how long it was. So it looked to me that it was a minute or two ride. Then on Thursday afternoon, about 2 or 3 o'clock, we go home for Shabbat. My house is very far. I have to get rides. I hitchhike. I come to the gate of the base. I see maybe 60, 70 soldiers are waiting. There's a line. Every 20 minutes, one car goes out, take 2 or 3 soldiers. We are 5, 6 hours here. I say to my roommate, they put me with a guy, the most angry person on earth. And when he gets angry, his right eye begins to move left and right. Something very scary. His eye goes like this. Then you know you better be quiet before you be dead. So they put me in a room with this guy. We both 18 years old soldier, 18 and a half. So I said to him, Aryeh Menashe was his name. Aryeh Menashe. I said, Aryeh, you want to stand here 6, 7 hours? Now remember, we have bags heavier than our bodies, full of all kinds of clothing, shoes, tape, radio tape. Whoa, carry it. In 110 degrees in a desert. So we stand over there 5, 10 minutes. Right away I lose my patience. You know, they say, how do you know Israeli when you go to Europe or country? You go to the supermarket, you stand 5 minutes online. The goyim come, they stand like this, like a statue, until they get to the line. The Israeli come, he stand half a minute, then he goes like this. Then 2 minutes later, excuse me, I have an emergency. He passes out. Oh, he goes out.
We look like a joke.
You know, in a plane, in the last Christmas, there was a plane coming, to Ben Gurion Airport. So he's landing. So the captain say, ladies and gentlemen, please do not untie your seat belt, and do not turn your cell phone on until the complete parking of the plane. Then after 5 minutes, he say, for those of you who are sitting with the seatbelt fastened, have a Merry Christmas. For those of you who are standing and talking on their cell phone, have a Happy Hanukkah. You know, everybody knows already. A Jew stands like this, is full of dynamite, full of energy. Right away, go crazy. You know, stand like this for 2 hours. So I'm 5 minutes in the place. I said to him, Aryeh, let's walk to the intersection. It's a main road. Over there, every second a car passes by. Well, over here, we wait until somebody leaves the base. He told me, but how far it is? Remember, we were only 2, 3 days in the base. We don't know. We don't know how far. I told him, no, it's 10 to 15 minutes walk. That's it. And it's down the hill, I said to him. He said, okay, let's walk. Now, you know, it's not a straight path. It curves around these mountains, and it goes like this, like a snake. So you don't know how far it is. You cannot see. So you walk 10 minutes. You hope that right after the curve, here is the intersection. You see another 10 minutes. We walk, another curve to the left, up another 20 minutes. After we walk for 2 hours, 2 hours we walk already with dripping in the desert that it's not so humid, we already dripping and the back is broken. and he's cursing me exactly every 15 seconds. Mizrachi, I'll butcher you. Go another 5 steps. Mizrachi, wait and see. You're going to shoe shine my shoe for 3 years. I don't know what I'm going to do to you. This, that. Why did I listen to you? Why? He gets in the middle and he begins to... And I'm shaking, you know. So imagine he has a knife or something. Then we walk. After 2.5 hours that we walk, a jeep comes. A jeep goes out of the base. What is it? Security. Patrol. Who? The chief officer over there. He goes with a machine gun, with a jeep. He comes. He looks at us. What are you two doing? Now remember, we are 2.5 hours walking already. I say to him, we're trying to go to the intersection. Over there's too many people. He says, are you crazy? You know how far you are from the intersection? I said, well, it's another 5 hours walk it's going to take you. It's 17 kilometers from the base to the intersection. I say, 17 kilometers? It looked like 2 minutes when I was falling asleep. He said, and besides, you don't know the regulation? You're not allowed to live without a weapon. Do you have a weapon? You know how many Arab Bedouin are here kidnapping soldiers? It's dangerous. I should arrest you right now. I said, well, we're only 3 days in the base. We didn't know. I said, go back. You have to listen good. Wow. Go back. Oh my God. I said, what do you mean go back? I said, well, what are you going to do? You're going to walk another 6 hours? I just told you it's illegal to walk like this. So I said to him, okay, you know, give us the ride back. He said, I'm sorry, I can't. I don't have helmets for you. Sorry. It's an open jeep. Open jeep without doors, you know. I don't have helmets for you. I'm not allowed to take you in a jeep. I said to him, so how do you expect us now to go up the hill? 2.5 hours down the hill. It's all down the hill. Now you want us to go all the way back? I'll die and I won't go back. So you have one choice. I'm going to the intersection. In 10, 15 minutes, I'll be back. If I see both of you continue to walk, I arrest you immediately.
It's better to arrest you.
What about your backpacks? At least take the backpacks.
We didn't care about the pack. I'm trying to go home now. Go back. It's like a dead sentence. I say to him, Arya Melashe, I don't know what you decide to do, but I'm not going back.
Really?
He says, what are we going to do? I say, let's go down to the Chevy over there. Go down. We walk through the mountain, parallel to the main road. I don't believe him, he's lying. But you really believe it's another 6 hours walk? Don't believe him, he just doesn't want us to continue to walk, so he told us this. He said, okay, I'm with you, forget it. All of a sudden we have water, we are wet all the way to our hips. We walk, and in the end we're almost fainting now. We need water, there's nothing, so we're going back to the main road. We're now hoping that he's not looking for us. He's probably going crazy. Where are these guys? Then a bus came, going to the base. A bus came. We stopped the bus. He took us back. Where? To the back of the line.
60 people.
This story, it's what life is all about. A person comes, Hashem puts him in this world. He goes to the wrong direction. Continue. He's stubborn. Torah say, no, this is the right way. Say, no, I'm going to do it my way. He go. In the end, Hashem takes him and pulled him all the way back. All your life was one big waste. You have to start from zero, and plus you have to get punished for all the mistakes you did. Not only you didn't get anything, what can be a bigger punishment? 2.5 hours and then another hour or so that we walked, and in the end we got back to the end of the line. That's what life is all about. Wake up now, not tomorrow. Now. Tomorrow may be too late. Don't miss the train. And I'll give you something to laugh about, to go home. One guy came to a store and he saw a huge line. 100 people standing online waiting for the owner of the store to open. He's a little guy. He stands. He's trying to pass the line. He go to the front. There's a big macho guy. Hey, where do you think you're going? He grabbed him, he picked him up in the air and throw him back to the end of the line. Get back to the end of the line. Then this guy comes back to the front, ta 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 ta. Hey, I told you don't cheat. Go to the end of the line. It throw him again. Next time you come, I break your bones. Then he comes third time, say, hey, don't touch me. If you're going to throw me back to the end of the line every time, who's going to open the store? It's my store. Let me. I'm trying to open the store. He keeps throwing me to the line. Thank you very much. Remember, the shiur is Monday. Monday you come.
In English.
In English, yeah.